I didn't know that, so there you go.
Do we have any idea what character she's going to be?
No clue. We don't know who any of them are going to be, other than, I mean, other than Mark Hamill, Harrison Ford, and Carrie Fisher, all the original people, we have no idea who any of them are going to play.
Wait, she's also Star Wars?
Huh? Yeah, she's going to be in the new Star Wars.
Okay, that's awesome.
Brienne's going to be in the Star Wars.
She's got to be like some alien thing. Monstrously big.
I feel like she's going to be like...
I feel like she's going to be a Wookiee. She's got to be a Wookiee.
She's going to be a Wookiee.
You're typecasting her. I feel like she's going to be some like Imperial officer or something for some reason.
Yeah, something like that.
I can just, I just have this image of her like wearing like the black Imperial costume and it just clicks for some... I don't know.
I just want her to be some like Sith badass or something.
Ooh,
That'd be awesome.
Did you see that not only did they cast her, they casted...
Lupita.
Whatever her name is from 12 Years a Slave. And there's already a bunch of photoshops of her like at the Oscars holding a lightsaber and stuff.
That's awesome.
It was a sad day, guys. It was a sad day.
It was very sad. Like, I wasn't prepared to be that sad, to be honest.
No, something about watching a guy get his skull crushed in just really takes it out of you.
Yeah.
You can read it a thousand times, but it's not that descriptive. But when you actually see it happen, that's just something else.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. Well, the bad guys, I mean, there's not really good and bad guys in Game of Thrones, but like the people you don't like decisively kicked the crap out of everybody last night.
Yeah.
Like Jorah got the boot and the Boltons took Winterfell. And...
There was only two happy storylines, I think. So that, except for the entire village that was dead.
That's true.
Oh yeah. It was marginally happy in the sense that the one character we knew didn't die and all the people there died. So
really the one character that I wish would have died lived.
Wow.
And then everyone else died.
Yeah.
All right, everybody, welcome to the cast, the Beyond the Wall, where we're discussing this absolutely. We're taking a moment to mourn after last night's episode. A real hero was lost. So what if he liked to have sex with anything that had legs? So what if he was really cocky, and so what if no one took him seriously? He was a great character, and we lost a big one, guys. It was tragic. And in this episode's wake is presented by our partners at WeGotThisCovered.com. That I am Caleb, the North Remembers Masters, and I am joined, as I am every week, with my brother-in-law, my friend. Introduce yourself, sir.
Austin Lucari. Very, very sad Austin Lucari.
He's a broken man, indeed.
Broken man.
This is the first time he actually is still locked in that... He has not left the room he's podcasting from since.
No. I've been sitting here ever since, just crying.
He was actually in a fetal position this morning when I found him. My regular host joining us from Oklahoma City. Sir, please introduce yourself.
Daniel Stoll.
We're going to get the show rolling because you know what? We're going to give Oberyn Martell the podcast send-off he deserves. Maybe not the ones he needs, but the one he deserves. And we're going to make it awesome, all right? So to start things off, to make this awesome, we are joined by my other really good friend. Sir, can you introduce yourself?
Yes, Drew Reese. I would say Drew the North Remembers Reese because that's how I feel right now, but just Drew Reese because you picked that.
That's right. Drew was here in the beginning of the podcast, and he is back again. For seconds or thirds. And we're really excited to have Drew on this week to kind of get his perspective on, the big fight. The fight, the mano-a-mano fight we're building up to. So thank you so much, Drew, for joining us today.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
All right. Well, before we go in and talk about all the ins and outs of the episode, because I want to highlight people, this was a great episode. There was more than just one epic thing that happened this week. But before we do, we're going to go ahead and ask Drew a couple questions. And kind of the question that is always popping up: what is your most memorable Game of Thrones moment? And that goes along to say, either in the show or the watching experience.
Oh, that's a good question. And I was thinking about this when I saw the outline earlier. And I always wonder, like, what do I remember? Do I remember the moments of pleasure? Or do I remember the moments of pain more? And by far, I remember the moments of pain where I was sitting. I remember what my face looked like when it happened, seeing all the tweets, like getting on Twitter immediately and saying, okay, what is everyone saying? Is everyone pissed like me? And of course they are, because I'm just like the stereotypical fan. I say what the most memorable Game of Thrones moment is, it's whenever Robb Stark dies and you really lose that hope of getting justice for the North, or the family getting back together, whatever you hold on to because you watched Disney when you were younger, that gets crushed with
And you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are, anything your heart desires will come to you.
Want to wish upon a star? Yeah, too bad.
I wonder what he does think of them. Like, if you guys were as fat as me, you would be pissed off all the time.
Why do I feel like we're gonna have a number of passive aggressive jabs towards George R. R. Martin this week? It's coming. I can sense it.
He's a sad, bitter little man.
Hey, man. It's like the tweet that went out. He said, you know, you got. Hey, he's warned us. He's given us plenty of warnings by now. We should have not been so invested. In the in those characters,
you should really stop liking this show. You should stop watching it now.
He's trying to make sure that we're not conditioned by the man that is Walt Disney. Okay,
he has officially done that for me.
I think he's legit making the world a worse place.
Wow. But see, Austin, this is all. If we're gonna get like real like philosophical, existential here. I think it's that George R. R. Martin is making the world a better place by showing us how terrible the world actually is, so we can make it a better place.
Yeah. All I know is he fills me with rage, and that puts everyone in danger.
Mr. McGee, don't make me angry. You wouldn't like me when I'm angry.
Thank you, Drew, for sharing that. And I actually do remember. I unfortunately missed viewing The Red Wedding with Drew, but I just remember thinking the whole season. So I got to know Drew a couple years ago. And he's reading the books, and he's like, but he watched the show first, and he comes up and he's like, Caleb, Rob is my favorite character. I'm like, oh, yeah? And I hadn't read I was reading book three, right? And then I found out what happens. I'm like, oh, crap. And then Drew starts reading the books, and I remember he comes up to me one day, he's like, Caleb, I think Rob's going to die. I was like, well, why do you think that? He's like, because he's not a main character in the books. He's like a side character no one cares about. You don't ever see him. He's totally going to die. I was like, well, nah, man. He's too important to die. There's no way that could ever happen.
Yeah, but you hesitated.
There was hesitation. So, yes, it was a very crushing moment of defeat. I thought, fitting with the theme of this week's episode, the Mountain versus the Viper, I thought it'd be a fun question to ask. If two Game of Thrones characters, dead or alive, I mean, you could even go to the histories if you really wanted to. Could get in a fight, for no reason. Just if they get in a fight, who would be in the fight, and who would you like to see in a fight, and who would win? Austin, go on with you, buddy.
I gave this some thought. It all centered around who I could pair up with Drogo. I got to go Khal Drogo versus pre-cripple Jaime Lannister.
Yes.
Oh, I like it. I like that choice.
I love the pick. You know, epic sword fighter versus like this giant barbarian rip dude played by Jason Momoa. I mean, it's pretty crazy.
Yeah, you can't beat that. He should have gone.
I really wanted to do Drogo versus Ramsay Bolton because they're both kind of crazy, but I don't think Bolton's very good at fighting necessarily, or at least we've never seen him.
He just looks epic.
Yeah. He just looked really, he looked very Drogo-ish when he came in all cut up and stuff a couple weeks ago. So
He definitely looked epic. Now, Austin, but who wins the fight?
Who wins?
Yep.
That's a tough question.
Probably Jaime. I think Jaime wins it.
You think Jaime?
Yeah. Drogo makes it look awesome, but I think Jaime wins it.
That's true. Drogo makes it a show. He does.
He takes too many risks, I think, when he fights.
I mean, he was the dude who like walked up while he was in a fight and got cut, and he just walked up to show how epic he was just because he could and be like, aha!
'Tis but a scratch. A scratch? Your arm's off.
No, it isn't.
Well, what's that then?
I've had worse.
Blood, what's that? And then he died. Daniel Stahl, who...
Mine is actually going to be one that the show has teased us with before. I don't know if you guys remember back at Blackwater in season 2, where the Hound and Bronn actually kind of have a little tease or whatever, where, you know, the Bronn does that thing where he turns around and grabs his little... sword dagger thing, whatever it was back there, and is about to fight the Hound. Then the things go off, and then the battle starts, and so they don't actually get to have the fight. That would be a really awesome fight, I think, to see two of the greatest fighters, I think, in Westeros. And the show has even teased it before. And I remember when they teased it, I was like, oh, that fight would be cool to see. So those that would be my choice.
And who would win?
I'm going to have to give it to Bronn, actually.
I actually think
it would be a very close fight. But I think Bronn has a little bit more, based on what I've seen so far, the Hound sort of just like charges in, and Bronn would have a little bit more,
but Bronn's got more maneuverability. Yeah, he's got
mobility.
More.
Yeah, that worked out real well this week, didn't it?
Well, no.
But what's interesting? Well, we'll get to that. We'll get to that. But what's actually interesting about them is both of them have actually fight very similarly in the sense of where they don't really fight with honor; they just fight to survive. Right. And I think that's what would make the fight so cool. Mm-hmm. Is we've seen Bronn before say, back at the Eyrie, where she says, you don't fight with honor. He says, nope, but he did. And, he takes Jamie's hands off and, slaps him with it, and like, that's the sort of fighter he is. But the Hound is also fights that way too. He doesn't really fight with honor. He just fights to kill whatever's in front of him and to survive. And right. So I think that would make that fight much more intense and more exciting to see, I think.
Yeah, and I think Bronn's got a lot more finesse is the key that I would probably give him.
Right.
I mean, obviously the Hound's got size and brutality, and like he's just looks tougher and he's got more meat on the bones.
I just feel like that would be a weaker version of the Mountain versus Oberyn.
No, because Oberyn's like actually a trained, skilled fighter. Bronn has got more finesse, and he is faster, and he can maneuver faster. But he's like, Oberyn was doing like backflips and crap, and like
Bronn still has more of that, meaty sort of heavy dude. Like he's still got the heavy side that the Hound has.
He's more like a street thug who actually has some skills, right?
Right. Yeah. So, whereas Oberyn's more like a back flipping ninja, I guess. I don't know.
Back flipping ninja of doom. All right, Drew. That leaves you. Who are you picking? Who's gonna get in a fight?
Okay, I'm going to borrow a little bit from Austin here just because this is what I thought of earlier, and I'm not switching it. I'd like to see the undefeated, who only lost to a wound, Khal Drogo, fight the insane madness that is the Mountain and the ultimate heavyweight showdown of all time.
That would be epic.
Yeah, I don't know what would happen. They may just taunt each other by like walking up and bumping chests for 30 minutes. Who knows? Who knows what happens? That would be insane.
Okay, so I would pay to see that show on prime time. I'd pay $30 or whatever it is to have a big watch party for that, because I think that'd be epic. I think I'm going to have to go with – it's been tough. I've been like through between two or three. I was thinking like Robert Baratheon in the heyday, the guy who killed Rhaegar Targaryen way back.
With the hammer.
With the big hammer versus
– damn, I was strong.
Oh, Robert, you were kind of a douchebag, but we all loved you anyway. But I probably would go with Robert versus. I'd probably go Oberyn just because it'd be cool. I don't know. But let's say Oberyn's out. Actually, no, I got a better idea. Robert Baratheon at his peak versus Jaime Lannister.
Oh yeah,
okay. That'd be a good one too.
I think, I don't know, just kind of for fun, because I feel like Jamie
would fight for the lady, apparently.
Yeah, oh gosh, yeah.
I got a bonus round for you, though. A bonus fight.
Okay.
Okay, Dario versus Worgd Hodor.
I forgot about Worgd Hodor. Hodor, oh gosh. What about just Worgd Hodor versus anybody? I mean,
How amazing would that be? Just ripping people to shreds.
He just goes in like... raging Hodor mode.
If he was, well, see, the thing is that we have to be Bran controlling it, because Hodor's not like a killer at any stretch of the imagination.
He's got to be Worgd. He's got to be someone in his head.
Yeah.
I think we can all agree, though, that this would make an epic fighting game, and they should produce that.
So, the people who made DC versus Mortal Kombat, just drop the DC and drop the Mortal Kombat. Just put Game of Thrones. Mortal Kombat Edition. I don't know.
Yeah.
Backwards. So HBO, if you're watching the show, and I know you are, and I know you want this, we want that HBO fighting game. Seriously, come on. All right, guys. Well, that was a lot of fun. I always love hypothetical fights just for no reason because they're kind of awesome. I don't know why. Let's do what we're here to do. We're here to dissect this episode. We're here to break down Game of Thrones and reveal the mysteries behind the curtain, which means we're going to like passively aggressive insult George R. R. Martin the whole time because that's what we do and we're bitter. Let's review this week's episode, The Mountain and the Viper.
What do you tell them?
I'm Theon Greyjoy, son of Balon.
Bring me Moat Cailin.
Lord Baelish has told many lies. I have to tell the truth.
Manson's army must be close. If they hit Mole's town, then we're next.
Do you think Oberyn has a chance?
You're going to fight that?
Grey Worm, Melisandre, they got a thing going on there.
Yeah, that was kind of interesting.
Very interesting.
Well, that's not actually where it started, though, right? It started with
We'll get there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I broke it down a little differently this week.
Okay.
Yeah. So that was kind of one of the first subplots to pop up, though, was Grey Worm and meet Melisandre. He just kind of really, like, totally stalkerish, comes out of that water like SEAL Team 6, you know, just his head just pokes his head up like that, and then there's Melisandre, she's just naked, and they just stare at each other before anything happens for like 30 seconds, and then she's like, oh,
I mean, maybe I should cover up a little bit.
Maybe I should cover up,
but I have to hit the quota first.
But
so
I have to hit the quota that perverts like Caleb enjoy, and we're gonna keep, you know, and before we can cover up and be like, oh crap, maybe I should not show myself naked.
He looks at her, then she stands up totally naked and is totally like obviously letting him look at her for like 30 seconds, and then she's like, okay, I'll place my forearm across my chest now and I'll be good to go. Obviously, from the beginning was like, please look at me, Grey Worm. I dig a man's form, or whatever she wants.
Well, this guy's checking me out. I kind of like this. Oh, wait. Oh, this is weird because we work together. Crap.
Never go anywhere.
Then she went and whined to Dany.
Do the Unsullied, do they do that? Can they do that? Yeah. Are they real human beings? Do they have sexual urges even though they don't have sexual parts?
Yeah. Well, I guess that's what I found so interesting about this is that these are supposed to be people that have been so broken down that they don't have emotions anymore. They don't think that way anymore. And yet we've seen Grey Worm have these sort of feelings, and they're not so really supposed to. So I don't know. I guess that it was really interesting. It's showing that they're not as dehumanized as maybe we thought they were. And they do have some thoughts and opinions on what's happening and feel – well, maybe not about so much what's happening yet.
Or maybe –
but they do have feelings in some sort of way.
Well, they're not just machines. And what I find interesting is maybe they were so broken down, but now they've been out and been freed for – they've been out freed for a while now. They're actually starting to develop like into actual people with actual desires and goals and stuff. So, you know, just kind of interesting and weird. Not in a bad way. I'm really – excited to see where this goes.
I enjoyed it. I liked it. I don't really know what to think of it.
Whenever Game of Thrones is finished, we're gonna have the HBO is gonna put together. They're gonna take all the Grey Worm clips and put it together in a documentary style drama, and it's gonna be called "Obama Begins: The Real Story." And,
that's right.
Then we're gonna find out where our president of the United States came from.
Taking place in Kenya.
Oh my gosh!
We thought this was fiction. This actually happens in Kenya every day, guys.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. And
the end of this is going to be him killing Osama bin Laden.
Yeah. With his bare hands.
The ultimate killer.
Oh, God.
No, I thought it was a good. I mean, it was probably kind of pointless, but it was fun because you got to see a little happy moment, which we didn't have much of this week.
Yeah, I mean, that was the point. It was one of the more upbeat storylines because they did resolve it to some extent, like not the whole subplot, obviously, but they resolved that incident where they were just like, yeah, I saw you naked. I'm really sorry about that.
Yeah,
no, I'm not.
It was really interesting how Grey Worm was like apologetic for it too, though. Like, I didn't really expect that for him to come and say, like, apologize. Like, he felt really bad about it. Like,
But then at the end he said no. Then he actually took it back because he said, "I'm glad you saw me." And then he's like, "I'm glad I saw you too."
Right, but he went through he was trying to be like a gentleman about it.
Oh,
it was sort of like, and I thought that was really interesting. Like, again, going back to how these are supposed to be broken killer warriors, and that's not what they're, and they're sort of coming out of that and becoming like, you know, like a, like he was being a really gentle, trying to be like a really nice guy in that situation, you know, to like, look, I'm sorry, I looked at you, you know, it was probably, it was wrong of me to do that, yada, yada, yada. I just thought it was interesting.
Well, that, I mean, it was a fun little subplot, but I think we can all agree that the really, the big moments of Marine this week was one that I think all of us knew was going to happen eventually, just was, it kind of came out really, just happened really fast, was that Dany and Jorah, they're breaking up, guys, and it looks like they're, looks like they're not getting back together, ever. This is really a weird turn of events, so Barristan gets that little letter, and I don't know, guys. I mean, I like Barristan enough, but I feel like I had an argument with someone about this. They're saying, well, it's just in his character because he's an honorable guy. I feel like he had ulterior motives for just outing Jorah. What do you guys think?
I don't know. He hasn't been characterized real well to this point, so I don't know that I could say that. It's possible, but I don't have any indication that, that that's the type of person he is yet.
I mean, we know, right, he's honorable. He's been defined as one of the most honorable men of all of Westeros. Even Ned Stark said he was honorable. So he's got that reputation. I just was like, you don't even give the guy a chance to, like, explain himself or anything. You know what I mean? I don't know.
But to defend Barristan a little bit here, and Daenerys to some extent, when this happened, when this occurred, he should have came to Dany and say, this is what I was actually sent here to do. And he never did that.
You're right. He didn't, because he was afraid of this would happen, and it did happen because he didn't.
Yeah, but waiting only makes it worse, right?
Yes. No, absolutely. I agree. I'm not saying Jorah made a good decision by not telling her.
Oh yeah, yeah,
yeah. Yeah, so I guess I defend Barristan a little bit. Like, he should have said something. Jorah should have said something a long time ago, and he didn't. And because he didn't, it looks like he was hiding it. And why was he hiding it? Maybe he's not really on Danny's side still. At least that's how, the way it looks. Dany probably made some bad decisions in this scene, but Barristan, I think, was in the right.
Yeah, he had to tell it. If you know that type of information and you're sworn to protect the queen, how could you not? I mean, that's just his job.
Yeah, I see I do see Barristan's, like, point of view. Like, I think that, you know, he has to tell her, but I also see where, like, and he does come and tell Jorah first. He's like, hey, I'm going to let her know about this so you can go ahead and prepare for what's going to happen. You know, he didn't just blindside him. Or he does, like he says, he goes and talks to a man-to-man and says, you know, hey, I found this information out. You know, I'm going to tell her. So in Barristan's point of view, I kind of see it. I do think there could have been some ulterior motives there. Maybe to kind of, like, secure his spot a little bit more with Dany, and, like, because now he's revealed that there's a betrayer amongst the, and, you know, in Danny's eyes, he's revealed this betrayer, and so now he's got a better spot. So I could see that a little bit, but I do think part of it was just he thought, you know, I have to tell her. I can't not have this, because if it ever comes back, I think it's also protecting himself too, because if it ever came out that, you know, he told her and then Barristan knew about it and didn't say anything about it, then Barristan's in trouble as well.
Right.
So, right. Yeah, so he's got a sort of protect himself some too.
Right, yeah, there's a lot of angles too. I just feel like, I mean, like, they know each other, right? I mean, I don't know. I feel like I would give them the benefit of the doubt to know that, to at least talk to Dany about it before
if he had went and came forward from the beginning, then yeah, this obviously, I don't think this would have been an issue at all. But he didn't, and now he's paying the price for it. And yes, this was a brilliant move by Tywin, I think.
Yes.
Who, do you guys think it was Tywin who did this?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah. They discussed this a couple weeks ago in one of the Hand of the King meetings or whatever, council meetings. He sent this pardon there to him so that he could sow discord within Danny's camp.
They did know Barristan and his character, so I guess that's fair. So they took it, they exploited that.
Mm-hmm.
And once again, Tywin wins the episode. This is like, if you were keeping count, he would be way up on everybody else.
God, freaking Tywin. Okay, Caleb respects Tywin. Caleb does not like Tywin after this episode.
Yeah.
All the bad things that happened in this episode were Tywin's fault. All of them.
And the thing is, like, if I'm in Tywin's position, like, he's making totally great moves.
No,
like, you know
totally
what I mean?
Is.
Like, that's the thing. That's the thing. Like.
Well, so, yeah, for the most part. But anyway, so what do you guys think specifically about the scene between Dany and Jorah, though?
It is not forged.
Why, then?
I send letters to Varys, the spymaster of King's Landing.
What was the content of these letters?
Information.
What information?
when you and Viserys arrived in Pentos. His plan to marry you to Khal Drogo when you were married. When your brother died.
You told them I was carrying Drogo's child?
Aye.
Yes or no?
Khaleesi.
Don't call me that. Did you tell them I was carrying Drogo's child?
Yes.
That wine merchant tried to poison me because of your information.
I stopped you from drinking his wine.
Because you knew it was poisoned.
I suspected.
You betrayed me. From the first.
Forgive me. Another man. Please, Khaleesi, forgive.
You sold my secrets to the man who killed my father and stole my brother's throne. You want me to forgive you.
I have loved you.
Love? Love? How can you say that to me? Any other man and I would have you executed, but you, I do not want you in my city dead or alive. Go back to your masters in King's Landing. Collect your pardon if you can.
He is Dany's most loyal confidant, like, and she, I mean, I know why she did what she did. She has to compensate,
right.
and she has to seem strong and powerful, so she doesn't want to make herself appear weak. But at the same time, it's like, this guy has been with you since the beginning, and yeah, maybe he didn't always work for you, but he stuck by you this whole time. And I wish he would have had more of a case to made for himself in this moment, because, I mean, the number of things he has done for her is just overwhelming, as opposed to what he has done, you know, to hurt her.
Right, and Daenerys gets really upset, and this may be as angry as we may have ever seen her in the show. I can't think of a moment where she's more angry, like, because this isn't just like her walking up to a bunch of slaves and she's mad that they're slaves. She feels like she's been 100% like completely betrayed by this person, which is something she hasn't necessarily experienced yet. You know, she got, like, you know, back in the season one, there was the witch that sort of kind of backs everyone, but it wasn't the same type. Like, this is supposed to be someone who's like your closest friend, you know, in some ways. So, but still, I do think she overreacted in this moment. I don't think that this was necessarily the best decision she could have made. She just gets really emotional. And she just gets really emotional and overreacts a little bit, I think.
I think so.
But I do understand where she's coming from at the same time.
How old is she at this point? Isn't she like 16 or something supposed to be?
Yeah,
is she supposed to be a teenage girl, something like that? Whatever she's supposed to be in the show, that's exactly how she acts. I mean, she's totally emotional, totally feeling hurt and betrayed. And it didn't show it in the show, and I don't know if this is intentional or not, but it didn't show her saying, well, on the one hand, Jorah has done all these things to help me further my cause, and he's been like a voice of reason and wisdom, and I've listened to him more than anyone else. I mean, who's going to advise her now? Like, Selmy's cool, but he's been in the Kingsguard. He's not going to be the same as Jorah. And then she definitely can't listen to the second son, Daario. She can't listen to Daario because he's crazy. She's cutting her own legs out from under her based on the fact that her pride was hurt and that she was hurt. And I think she's just reacting like a girl without good counsel would be, or even I would be if someone hurt me. It's just, you know, out of emotion.
Yeah. We get accused of being, jokingly accused of being being a bunch of misogynist males. So it's clear. No, 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 it's okay. Former guest host Dalton Stewart tweeted us this week and said, Daenerys is probably going to get a thrashing tonight. And he's like, well, it's because you're a bunch of misogynist tools. Okay. Yeah. I think Drew's got it onto that. I think it is more of an age thing than a gender thing, so we're not going to go down that road. And, hey, this is great. If there are any viewers out there who are women who want to comment about their thoughts on this scene right now, we will totally talk about this during the break.
She's young. She's young. She's inexperienced. That's why she made the decision she made.
Right.
It is interesting, though, that similar things have happened to other kings in Westeros, Stannis being one of them, and they reacted to it very differently. Stannis locked up Davos, but didn't banish him.
Right.
He
was going to kill him.
Yeah, but he didn't. He was smart enough and experienced enough to know, I'm going to let him sit there for a while until I truly make up my mind. And that's the type of thing she hasn't learned yet. She's impulsive.
Right.
And she's very makes decisions that she doesn't have to make right now. She could have just locked him away until she figured out what she really wanted to do with him.
And maybe sought some counsel on it or something. Like, she didn't. She just makes a decision while she's at her one of her most emotional points.
She just reacts. She does what reacts. Dany has done the whole time. And you can – this is not necessarily a criticism or an applause. I'm just saying this is what Dany does. She is highly impulsive. She lives in the – she makes decisions that are best in the moment. And she makes crap up as she goes along. And
her greatest strength and weakness.
Exactly. And no, that helped out. She freaking look at all the cities she freed, and like just by acting really confident. Which guess what, something that we don't get to see is inside of her head. She's not very I mean, just like most human beings, she's actually not that confident, but she feels like she has to be, and she has to come across very strong willed and heavy handed for a number of reasons we've talked about, because she's a woman in Westeros, for, you know, right her age. But I think Drew hit the nail on the head. I think it really is a pride issue more than anything, because she feels like her trust has been misplaced, and for her to show that to show the other people that she does trust, her small counselor or whatever, that she will have grace towards this type of attitude would demoralize her, not demoralize, but weaken her character, like publicly.
Yeah.
You know, people would say, "Oh, well, he betrayed you, and you didn't do anything about that. What do you know? But you hung all those slaves up. You know what I mean?" I feel like this is definitely her overcompensating.
Actually, that's actually pretty interesting. I just maybe I'm jumping too far with this parallel, but as you were speaking, I made this parallel, like back to Rob in season 3 when the car start comes up, and he says, "What if I don't kill him? They're going to say all these things about me, that I'm weak and that I can't even take care of my own camp." And then look what happened to him. So I'm not saying in any stretch of the imagination that's what's going to happen to Dany, but I just kind of made that parallel as you were talking. It sounded similar to that situation.
Can we all agree?
It's different,
if there are any viewers out there who want to chime in, I really want to know what you think. But can we all, at least on this podcast, agree she made a really terrible mistake?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And I think it is going to severely cost her, because she doesn't, like you guys said, she doesn't really have a voice of reason anymore.
What if Jorah was still working against her? The thing that you're going to do is send him away, and now he has all this information on you, and he's just walking out. So I'm not saying that I think he's definitely not working. Like, he is definitely like completely in love with her and completely devoted to her. But like, if she assumed that he was still against her or whatever, then this is even a worse decision, because now he's out with all this information. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
So
wasn't very smart move. And guys, it really, I don't know, it really just hurt when like he was saying, "I fought for you and I killed for you," and then he said, "I loved you," and then like she just like totally crapped on him. She's like, "You didn't love me." I was like,
which is way too late to say. He should have said that a long time ago. By the way,
he should have said that a long time ago.
That was his
own. I think, like, because Rob didn't have this kind of relationship with Karstark that Daenerys had with Jorah.
Right. No, and you're right. It is different. I just thought there was something kind of similar there while he was talking.
No, yeah, I agree. And I was actually wondering while you were saying that, like, what if the roles were reversed? What if, like, I don't know, this is crazy, but like, what if Rob Stark had dragons and was across the sea and Daenerys was in Westeros? Would she be alive right now if she was in Westeros? Like, what do you guys think?
Yeah. They'd still both be dead. I think Dany would be dead in Westeros and Rob would be dead in Essos, because they're the same impulsive person.
Yeah, and that was the point I was trying to make, so I don't have any like feminists jumping down my throat here. But they both made mistakes out of the arrogance of youth.
Yeah.
And so Rob was a young guy, his hormones got to him, whatever. He married someone he shouldn't have. He did stupid stuff, and I think she's doing the same kind of stupid stuff right now.
I mean, her and Dario, they hit it off. You know,
yeah,
and now she's sending away her most trusted advisor and most valuable advisor.
Yeah,
yeah,
who was clearly against the Dario in the first place, which I think he is very smart for saying those.
He's like one of the most untrustworthy people she's ever been in league with. Period.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm calling it now. By the way, Dario is getting eaten by a dragon.
Oh,
it's gonna happen.
That'd be awesome. Epic. I'd watch that. I thought this was a really powerful moment. I think there's a lot of great moments in this episode, guys, and I want to make sure we actually give all these moments the attention they deserve, because I know that fight at the end was so freaking incredible. But this was only one of many, I thought, really powerful moments. So let's go ahead and move on to something I didn't actually expect to see so quickly. I honestly thought when Littlefinger threw Lysa Arryn out the moon door, initially, before I saw the little sneak peek, I was like, I bet that's the end of the season. Like, I bet we don't see him and Sansa again until next season. Nope, next episode. I love how Littlefinger plays the game, and he's like, oh, well, she just committed suicide. Eh, sucks. You know, I was just, I don't know. The way he just delivered that line was really funny. It was dead,
yeah.
So Sansa is stepping up her game.
We see in the trial scene, and when I first was watching the little trial scene where Littlefinger's there, and then Sansa comes in and starts saying, like, you know,
Lord Baelish has told many lies. All to protect me. Since my father was executed, I have been a hostage in King's Landing. A plaything for Joffrey to torture or Queen Cersei to torment. They beat me, they humiliated me, they married me to the imp. I had no friends in King's Landing. Except one.
I was like, okay, Littlefinger trained her up and got her to say the right things. And then we see the scene where they're in the little cell where she's like making that dress or whatever. And she said, and he walks in and he says, why did you lie for me? And I realized, oh, wow, she made this move on her own.
Yeah.
She did not get talked up by Littlefinger and wasn't told what to say, which I was like, wow, that's awesome. I got really excited for Sansa. And then the next thing we see is when Sansa comes down in this dress that Littlefinger looks to be like just stunned by, can't even sort of mutter any words, and she sort of like gives this little smile and's like, let's go. And
she's named it. That was, she looked a lot like Catelyn. Like Catelyn.
And one of the comments online was, someone's been shopping at Hot Topic.
And you know, I think Sansa is starting to figure out how to play the game a little bit, and that's super exciting for me. I'm really getting behind her character. She definitely moved up on my favorites list after this episode. And I think she's going to start trying to play Littlefinger a little bit. I think she realizes how Littlefinger was in love with Catelyn and how she can maybe play that aspect. But I do think that that's kind of where her story's headed. And I think that's super exciting. I actually really love where that's headed. And because I think that's where it's headed.
She's actually making decisions for herself. She's not being told what to do.
Being active and she's not necessarily responsive or whatever.
I agree with you, Daniel, that I do think she's trying to play Littlefinger. She's using some of the skills that she learned, honestly, mostly in King's Landing, and she's picked up a few things from Littlefinger too.
Yeah, and she's learned some things in Little. It's clear she's learned stuff in King's Landing for sure.
But the question becomes, what is she after? What could she possibly want from him? So that's what I don't know. Yeah. And part of me thinks like maybe she has a little thing for him. Maybe she has a bigger plan. I don't know. I don't know what she could possibly get from him as I just.
Do I feel like I do feel like Sansa and Littlefinger are going to develop a really unhealthy relationship? Because
I feel like right.
Yeah.
Well, no, I'm just saying, like, I don't know, because I'm with you. I don't know what Sansa wants, but she's totally playing it. But she's totally intentionally playing into his desires there. And it's the only real pressure point he has. He's too smart to be beaten by anybody else. But she's the only person who could actually undermine him and kind of manipulate him a little bit.
Caleb,
he said it right. Littlefinger said that if you can keep your enemies confused about what you want, then they'll never be able to like beat you.
Right.
And I think Sansa's doing. We don't know what she wants. Yeah. I don't think Littlefinger knows what she wants. And I'm pumped to see them develop her character. I think she's really there's a lot of depth to her character that the show hasn't done justice. And I think we're gonna get to see it coming up because she really is like making decisions for herself finally and coming into her own. I think she's gonna be a really powerful player. Like Littlefinger's a powerful player, but if she's the one playing him, she could be just as strong.
Right. And when I'm wondering, I'm sensing a little bit of a potential Lady Macbeth theme here going on. The woman behind the man, you know, controlling the man in power type thing. No, I don't know if it's going to go
completely crazy.
And then goes, no, I totally could see that. These people have
sisters. The crazy
that's
one.
Arya the psycho. Yeah.
Well, Arya is kind of a psychopath.
Sansa understands Littlefinger a little bit more than we give her credit for, because back in the scene where they're in that little room or whatever, and he says, do you know what I want? She's, or you don't know what I want or whatever. And she says, she basically says, yeah, I know what you want. And then she comes out in that dress and she's
basically. No, that's what I'm saying. I'm totally giving her credit for that. That's why I said that, right. Like the Lady Macbeth complex is going to happen.
I think about what Sansa wants. I think for right now, she wants Littlefinger to be interested. I think she wants Littlefinger to have those sort of desires and to keep those there, because if he ever will lose that, then maybe she becomes in danger again.
Right.
And so I think for now, she's just sort of like, I want you interested in me. I want you to stay close to me, because if that's the case, then I'm going to be safe.
Right.
If that makes sense.
You know, she'll protect her. Yeah, no, absolutely. I actually do think to some degree, even though she was lying in that scene with the council, there was some truth, a hint of truth there, that she does see him as her only friend, even if she knows that he's using her to, I don't know.
Great acting job by Sansa, and the actress too. But Sansa did a really good job of playing that whole, like, I'm crying and it's all emotional, and like get the jury on her side. Oh, yeah. Basically, I thought that was really, it's really clever.
One thing we should touch on before I move on here, though, is Robin.
Yeah, and how
Littlefinger's using it. So Robin is awesome. Littlefinger is definitely attempting to unite the veil behind Robin.
Right.
At the same time, he wants to send Robin away.
Right. Well, he's got Robin's going to go rally support for himself while Littlefinger rules the Vale, and then Robin loves Peter, so of course Peter will control him. While even when he's away, he'll rule, and then when he gets back, he's going to be a pawn.
Yep, yeah, I totally agree. Does he intend on Robin coming back? I don't know.
Robin could just fall off his horse.
It would be kind of crazy if John Arryn, then Lysa, then Robin just all die.
They all died by Littlefinger's hand.
Seriously.
But it would get really suspicious, I would think.
Well, I mean, the thing about Littlefinger is he knows that he cannot be the symbol of the Vale. He knows that he will never be able to unite them together on his own, because he's not from there. He doesn't have that bloodline. He doesn't have the name. But all the rest of them, but he knows Robin does. Even if Robin's freaking crazy, he knows that he's got the name power. People remember John being this great leader, so they'll get behind his son. So very smart move, very, very ingenious. And I don't want to, we spent a lot of time on Littlefinger, so I want to move on. I think Littlefinger is doing what he does best. He's still playing the game, except for now, instead of playing it, he's playing a smaller scale game in the Vale, you know, as opposed to in King's Landing with all these big dogs. He's now trying to take over the Vale so that, again, he can move up. So, well played, Littlefinger, and Sansa, playing the game. But before we leave the Vale, we can't forget about Arya. Guys, I'm really unnerved here.
I'm sorry. Just thinking about this scene makes me laugh.
Oh, there you go. When the only thing she gets excited about is killing people, I think there's a problem. Like, how long before we don't really like Arya anymore, or at the very least, like, really just constantly disturbed by her? Because every scene with her this season, I've just become, like, less and less. I'm like, oh, gosh. She is so dark and twisted. Like, it's so sick. You know what I mean? Like, she's been broken down. And then, like, when the guy says, yeah, your Aunt Lysa died, she started laughing.
She starts laughing. It's hilarious. I'm sorry. I lost it. I don't know if it was just me. Like, I felt like I was the only one in the room laughing, but I thought that was hilarious when she was busted out laughing. Like,
it was fitting, and it was kind of funny. It was also kind of unnerving. At least I thought so. Well, I mean, I understand why she's laughing.
Less unnerving and more sad. She's broken because everywhere she goes, everybody's already dead.
Yeah.
You know? And her family, like, it's all her family too. Like,
yeah, I feel really, really just sad for her, because that's not the person she ever wanted to be.
No, exactly.
But it's frankly what everyone has turned her into. And I hope that all the people that have made her who she is suffer by her hands, and it's going to be fabulous. But I don't know if it'll end up happening.
No, because that's a traditional story, Austin. That's a traditional revenge story. That's The Crow.
People once believed that when someone dies, a crow carries their soul to the land of the dead. But sometimes, something so bad happens that a terrible sadness is carried with it, and the soul can't rest. Then sometimes, just sometimes, the crow can bring that soul back to put the wrong things right.
That's not going to happen. True. This is Game of Thrones. You do get, there's not really justice I mean, there is justice, but they're not, it's just not like, it's more realistic.
No,
unless
there,
like,
there is no justice
poetic.
Even the there justice. Is no justice, and we will get to that.
Yeah,
Maybe there's justice. It's not the type of justice you want to see, because you can't forget. Because you can't forget, Joffrey still died in a very terribly morbid, painful way.
That wasn't bad enough.
Well. I'm just saying there is justice, and Lysa Arryn did die, and she was crazy. So I'm just saying there is justice out there. It's just not the way we want to see it. Maybe, I don't know. Interesting question. I don't know, guys. I think we're seeing the birth of the Joker. I mean, she just started laughing, and I'm like, oh crap. Freaking, she's gonna, next thing you know, she's gonna be blowing up hospitals, and we're gonna be like, oh god.
You wanna know how I got these scars?
That's what's going down next, guys.
It is funny that she was so close, like so close to being back.
Yeah, she was so close to one of her siblings or one of her family members, just right there.
Every time. She was so close to Rob, she could see the frickin', she got into the twins, and then no. She gets to the Vale, and their aunt's dead, so something tells me they're going to turn around and not go into the Vale and see that frickin' Sansa's there.
They don't know Sansa's there.
Exactly. Which makes it that much worse.
Yeah.
No, I don't think they're going to turn around. I would imagine if they claimed that, you know, one of the guards is going to go tell somebody, like, hey, we have a Stark at the door. Maybe someone should look into this.
We'll see what happens.
If Littlefinger finds out about it, that's just another pawn for him, I would think. I think she has to get reunited. Maybe not.
We thought that 3 weeks ago with Bran and Jon, too. Guess what didn't happen, Austin? It didn't happen.
So I take it what you're getting at is that this is not in the book. Is that what you're getting at?
I'm not going to make a comment on that. Whatsoever. No. No, what I'm saying is that I thought the show was going to throw us a freaking bone and we were going to get a reunion. Like, I really actually thought it. I believed it. And they're like, nope. Just joking. George R. R. Martin likes to play the same game. At some point, though, guys, this game of, hey, the Starks are almost reunited is going to get a little old, okay?
Like, yeah, seriously. It's been old.
Yeah.
Quite a few old things in this episode that we'll talk about more later.
I can just hear the depression in Austin when he speaks about later.
No, he was broken today. I'm not even joking. I mean, I was joking with the foot position thing, but he's like literally less happy. I'm not even making this up, guys. He's a sadder person today. He's like, he literally said before this game, he's like, you know what? I don't even care who dies. Tyrion could die and I wouldn't even care. And I was like, oh crap.
Wow. Well,
that's a big statement.
It's the truth. At this point, Dany could be dead. Tyrion could die. Everyone could die and I'd be fine with it. That was the worst one. But we'll get there. We'll get there.
last thing I want to note on is, do you think the Hound's infection is going to be relevant whatsoever?
Yeah, he's dead, man.
Morbid Austin, gosh. Maybe
everybody dies, okay? That's what I've come to know.
No,
everyone
Austin,
dies.
Not everyone dies, because you know what? Well, Samwell Tarly is still alive. That's why I know everyone doesn't die.
That's bad.
Yeah.
Okay. Here's the thing. Here's the thing with Sam. All right. Maybe he is. He lives forever, and it shows that fat people can live on forever, and George R. R. Martin can actually finish the books.
Wow. So much negativity.
George R. R. Martin better watch out because Austin's gonna freaking he's.
I'm gonna come after him with some bacon, and he'll never make it through.
I always think that authors write themselves into the story, and for a while I thought George R. R. Martin wrote himself in as Tyrion. I think he's Sam Tarly, though.
He is actually Sam Tarly.
He's the bumbling, stupid, fat bastard who makes Austin angry every week.
But you know what, Sam? But you know what, Sam is really good at reading books and telling stories.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's true.
I hate it.
But you know what? The world needs Sams, because then we get Game of Thrones. And after Austin, would you really want to live in a world without Game of Thrones?
We'll see how next week's episode goes.
Okay, gosh. Well, guys, we have reached our first question and answer break. We will take your questions, and we do have at least one, maybe two, sitting here in the wings. But I want to remind everybody who is tuning in via YouTube or who's listening to us later, make sure to find us on Facebook.com at Facebook.com/CastBeyondTheWall. Or you can follow us at Twitter at @cast_beyond_GOT. Or if you're watching on YouTube, just hit that little subscribe button there. We'd like to see that. And best of all, you know what you could really do that I would love to see? Subscribe to us on iTunes. That would just be really fantastic. And I also want to remind people tuning in that we are partnered with WeGetThisCovered.com. And you guys know what? I saw some photos from the set of Star Wars this morning. There's a lot of Star Wars news today, but I saw set photos. that were probably illegally taken because that's how paparazzis work. But you know where I saw it first? WeGotThisCovered.com. You want to know how I saw that Brienne of Tarth and Lupita, whatever, from 12 Years Slave?
Don't worry about it. Just say your first name. It's fine.
Lupita is going to be in the new Star Wars because of WeGotThisCovered.com. They broke the story first. And you know what movie is coming out this weekend that has a really great review? Edge of Tomorrow. They've already got it posted up, and I highly recommend everyone check it out. For our first question, we've talked about Littlefinger a lot this season, but we'll go in on this anyway. From Wesley Thomason is, what do you think Littlefinger is really trying to achieve?
Oh, man.
That's a really open-ended question.
You have 6 hours, Wesley? Because we might be able to crack that egg.
If we sit here for long enough.
I think he legit ultimately wants the throne. I do. And he's going to do so by murdering everybody or convincing them to murder each other. But I do think that's his ultimate goal.
I tend to land the camp that he does want the throne, and he wants Catelyn Stark. We talked about that there's this weird complex going on between his desire for power and lust for Catelyn Stark, kind of really weirdly intertwined. But I don't think he wants the throne. I mean, I think he wants the throne, but I think he wants it for different reasons. I feel like the idea of the throne is a lot more interesting to Littlefinger than the actual ruling. I really feel that way. And it's because
it's the accomplishment.
It's the accomplishment of getting there, showing being an FU to the world. You know, that someone from his position couldn't make it that far. And again, he was humiliated as a child, and he's trying to kind of get back at the world for screwing him over, essentially.
And in that respect, he's a lot like Daenerys, because I felt like originally all she was focused on was getting the throne and not actually ruling. I think that's kind of where Littlefinger is right now.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that he wants to basically be to that point where he could have it. But I think in the end, he doesn't want to be the one ruling. He wants to be the man controlling the man that's ruling, if that makes sense. He wants to be the man behind the curtain, basically.
He wants to be Tywin.
He would be much happier in that position where he's not on the throne, but he is the one in control.
I think that right now, though, he's just climbing that ladder of chaos trying to get to the top. But who knows if he even knows what he'll do when he gets there, like you guys are saying. Like, he'll probably try to rule the guy who's ruling.
Right. Well, it's kind of like he has I think this is why he's obsessed with the idea of it. It's because it's like he has no real end goal. Like, I mean, he knows the throne is the end goal, but like everything between there is just weird. You know, it's like it's some imaginary thing that he'll never actually obtain, I guess, is kind of how I've looked at it.
And the way he talks, just his accent even, I feel like what he really wants is his lucky charms.
Have to be lucky charms. Oh gosh, yes.
That's the story his accent and facial hair tells.
Yes.
Let's talk about the North. And we actually had two storylines going on in the North, three and a half. First off, I want to say the Thins have arrived. Finally. They've been running around killing potato farmers for the last like 3 weeks, but finally they show up again. And they're actually killing bad people as opposed to sweet potato farmers who are sharing happy, cheery moments with their son.
Who'd they kill that was bad?
These were like, well, okay, not bad.
The whoremongers.
Sorry, well, they were, okay, sorry. Okay, they were killing low people who would be considered low profile, like...
Right, because their lives aren't as important.
Well, I mean, every life's important. Are we going to get into the sanctity of life discussion on air, Austin? I'll do it. I'll do it right now. No, sorry. So, they're not bad guys. They were killing innocent bystanders either way, but they were prostitutes and dudes who were paying for sex, which, you know, it's pretty messy. I just sounded like a really condescending person right there. Well,
yeah, you're a bad person.
I am a bad person. It's true. I believe in the sanctity of all human life. I don't care what you do. You're good. You're valuable. I love you. Okay, so anyway, moving on. I promise I'm not a bad person. I love everybody. I just... you know, guys, you know what? Okay, tell me if any of you... that the same thought remotely crossed your mind. This is a really weird parallel. But for some reason, that opening shot of the episode... I couldn't get out of my head. It reminded me of two scenes I have seen, and I don't draw comparisons to Lord of the Rings very often, but the way it was shot reminded me of when they go to Bree in The Fellowship of the Ring, and especially in The Hobbit Part 2 at the very beginning. I don't know. It was just the way they executed it, like a bunch of dudes just sitting around drinking and making jokes and stuff. And it just had that dark, kind of rainy atmosphere. I don't know.
I agree with you. Even when the wraiths come in Bree, and they're like real silent, and then you have Gilly like hiding in the closet, and there's like a little kind of clip in Lord of the Rings where there's someone like hiding in a corner as the wraiths come by, and they're like just murdering.
I did not necessarily draw that parallel. Like when I saw it, I didn't think about it.
Mm-hmm.
But that's an interesting thought. I don't know what it means, but
Austin, I hate to tell you. I mean, actually, no, I don't hate to tell you. I am excited to tell you. Guess what? All those people died, but you know who didn't die or probably didn't die?
God damn it.
Gilly is still alive. She's still kicking strong, Austin. She's going to be there with her baby.
I hope. Okay, fine. They're going to keep Gilly alive. I hope she is so pissed off and just beats the living shit out of Sam Tarly.
Okay, and then it was really funny because then it cuts to Sam's like, well, guys, that was a bad idea. And we're all like, no, Dip, you freaking idiot. You left her in a brothel. A freaking brothel in the north where you knew wildlings were there. I mean, he knew the wildlings were beyond the wall. That's what's crazy. Yeah.
One point about, I don't know if this is important or not. I was reading or watching something, I don't remember, about this episode, and they brought up the point of did she leave Gilly alive because there's a baby, or did she leave Gilly alive because she knew that she was a wildling? I don't know if that's important or not, but they sort of discussed it on the YouTube review that I was watching. I don't know if like what you guys thought about that.
I don't. How would she know she was a wildling?
Yeah, there's like,
it's like just something you got. Like you look at her and you have a sense, like sort of like the girl was saying beforehand.
They share a connection.
Telepathy.
Telepathy connection.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, that makes sense.
The little waitress girl or whatever that was doing the burping was kind of saying before, like she just maybe there's just that sense about her that she looks and like a wildling or whatever. I don't know. It was just something they brought up. I didn't know if you guys had any thoughts about that.
I do. You know what I think happened? I think George R. R. Martin is listening to this podcast and he knew Austin hated her. And he's like, he hates Sam. And he's like, you know what? He calls up Dan Weiss and the creators and he's like, guys, don't kill her. I've got this one fan. He just hates Sam and I want to make his life miserable. Keep her alive. Why? How are they going to? I don't know. Just make something up. Just make something up. Make it not happen. Because Austin was probably clenching his seat thinking, God, she's going to die. Sam's going to be so sad. But no.
I think more than anything, this was a character moment for Egret. We got to see her complete ruthlessness and brutality. But at the same time, she still has a little bit of compassion. She's still human. And I think it's because of the baby. Because no one really likes Gilly, so.
No, okay. Game of Thrones has a lot of things, and they have even killed babies, but you haven't seen them kill a baby. It was implied, and you hear about it, and you hear screaming, but you do not see a baby get stabbed. This show's not going down that road. I don't think so.
She might have known who Gilly was, though. I mean, Gilly, for all we know, is like five generations inbred from Craster's Keep. She's going to have a really distinct look. Like,
who knows? All of them look exactly the same. They're like clones.
Yeah, I mean, you know, those Crasters all look pretty alike. And you know, Gilly looks like a very, very special case of Craster. So.
So what is this for Egret now? Like, is this 45 total seconds of screen time this season?
This whole season? I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. This is bad. I like her. It makes me sad.
Yeah, it makes me sad too. But hey, good news is, Drew, and good news for all of us, we're gonna see a lot more Egret next week. We're gonna see Mance Rayner light the biggest fire the North has ever seen from like a year and a half ago. It's gonna happen. And we're gonna see freaking.
How much did that guy get paid, by the way?
Probably a lot of money because he's actually a big name actor.
He's only been on screen for like a minute tops.
Yeah, that's true.
Entire series.
He was only in three episodes briefly. It's okay.
I want his job.
You want his job? Yeah. He's gonna just he has one job, Austin. It's to light the biggest fire the North has ever seen.
Biggest fire, yeah.
So anyway, but I think we're gonna see more Egret next episode, and hopefully we'll get to see, what was cool about season three as a whole was we got to see Jon interact and see what the wildlings are like. But this season was him back with the Night's Watch. So we haven't really been able to see a whole lot of that. We've only seen the more brutal side of them. So I'm hoping next episode pulls a Blackwater, where we kind of are rooting for both sides a little bit. Because I like Ygritte, and I actually like Tormund quite a bit, and I actually do kind of respect Mance Rayner. So, like, I don't want to see any of them die, but it's also going to be a battle, and, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of always wanted, and I think a lot of the fans did, wanted Jon Snow to run the Wildly army. Like, he'd be the leader of it eventually, and obviously he was very loyal, so that didn't happen, but.
Well, yeah, I do. I will say
he could pull the rug out from others next episode and actually end up fighting for the Wildlings.
I know. Ygritte took his V card. That has to mean something. I think she's got a big role to play coming up.
I mean, because you know when women take your V card, they have quite a bit of power over you usually. So, you know.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that they're both.
Maybe if you're a wuss.
Well, Austin.
My gosh.
Well, there you go. There you have it. Austin McCart. Apparently, he thinks. Never mind.
Don't have any love for anyone ever, okay? That's the moral of this week.
I think the honorable thing for our species to do is deny our programming. Stop reproducing. Walk hand in hand into extinction. One last midnight, brothers and sisters opting out of a raw deal.
I will say, hinting on a lot, before we leave the ghillie scene, raining blood.
I do think that next week's episode is going to be all one episode based on the little like preview for next week. It's the wall. So I'm pretty sure that next week's all the wall. Like it's there's not like it was a Blackwater back in season two.
They hired Neer Marshall, who directed Blackwater, to direct this episode. Everything points to the fact that we are not going to see anything outside of the wall, which I am totally cool with.
Yeah, and which is fine.
It's going to be epic. And we are going to find out the answer to the question, how do 102 men fight off 10,000? And it's going to be freaking insane. And there's going to be giants.
Giants.
So that was kind of North setting up for next week. And that, I mean, I know the North has been kind of the wall has been kind of a slow build storyline for the most part. I mean, they had that whole thing where they went beyond, but it hasn't really gone anywhere. But I think next week we're finally going to see the payoff to all this kind of slow build.
Right.
Now, also in the North this week, we got reunited with Reek, or should I say Theon Greyjoy,
whoever he is,
who can only stay he's like a transformer. He transforms into Theon mode, but then he's like a really malfunctional transformer because he short circuits after about 5 minutes. He's like, I am Theon, blah blah blah, and then he's like, Reek, or Theon, I'm Theon, Reek, Theon, you know. He was going like haywire in there, you know.
He pulled the Robert Downey Jr. from Tropic Thunder this week.
I know who I am. I'm a dude playing a dude disguised as another dude.
What?
You a dude that don't know what dude he is.
Or are you a dude who has no idea what dude he is and claims to know what dude he is?
It was awesome.
But, you know, I gotta say, I gotta hand it to Alfie Allen. No matter how you feel about Theon or his arc, and I know this season hasn't necessarily been the most exciting arc, especially in comparison to everything else we've seen, that actor's doing a really good job. Alfie Allen's doing a really great job playing this really... Now he's so confused. Like, before he was tragic and was kind of evil, but... Now he's so broken, he doesn't even know who he is anymore. Like, he has to have a dude tell him who he is. You know, it's sad, and it takes a lot of acting. And even if you think Theon deserves to, like, burn in the Ninth Circle of Hell or something like that, the actor's doing a good job at playing that.
Theon has served his sentence, I think, already.
I think Theon should have died instead of Oberyn. I think he should have had his skull crushed.
That's fine. That would have been better than what he ended up as.
I mean, I still am in the camp that Theon... I just want to see him suffer more. And I liked watching his face whenever he saw his own people with their bodies flayed. Oh. I was like, okay, now you get a little taste, man.
Wow. Man.
So I need to be honest with Drew here because I know I got Greyjoy. Do you have like a secret flank room in your dungeon that's in your basement? You know,
I blame Theon for what happened to Rob, even though it really was Rob's fault. Part of me just needs someone to find that isn't Rob.
If Theon had actually done like he was supposed to.
Theon's fault. Rob whenever he didn't send whatever he was supposed to do. I don't even remember now. He was supposed to do something, and he set a letter on fire, and it was ridiculous.
Yeah, okay, okay. So he left. He was supposed to bring back the Iron Islands into the fold on the side of the north, which he knew was never going to happen. Fine.
No.
But the thing that he did that was really annoying was he wrote this really heartfelt letter about how he was sorry, and at least let him know what was going on. That he really still loved Rob, and then he burned the letter, and then Rob found out that he burned those two farmers and said it was his Rob's brothers. And then
Rob Stark was retarded. He was going to die at some point, regardless.
We're gonna have a legit
stupid
fight happen.
And him and his retarded mother, some of the worst characters in the show. I said it. I've said it before.
If your best friend, or supposedly your brother, who swears his sword to you like third or fourth, I don't remember what it was, says he's going to go rally troops for you, and then the next thing you know, he's killing your brothers and sacking your home. That's really messed up, and you're going to be a little distracted from your priorities. And
he's a prisoner. Really, he wasn't a brother. He was a prisoner.
But he kept himself as a brother.
Theon said he and Rob both even said to each other, like, they were like brothers to each other, basically.
Am I your brother now and always? And then he says, yes, now and always. And then
that's survival. You gotta say that.
Oh, wow.
Okay, so Austin, I just want you to know when the moment comes, this conversation happens, I am your brother and I will backstab. You're telling me to survive, I should backstab you.
If I'm holding you as prisoner, then yeah.
So, Oh my gosh.
Back to our question at the beginning, the fights I want to see. I want to see a Drew and Austin fight now because that looks like what's going to happen.
I want to see this. I mean, an epic arguing match.
What was it? Season 2 or 3, whatever it was on the podcast, I said Caitlin, Rob, and Jorah are the characters I hate the most.
That's fair enough. I mean, if you hate him, you hate him. So.
It's not even that I just hate them. I just didn't find them very interesting. That's all.
So he wanted them to die, basically.
I wanted to move on. Sam's up there now, though. So
Sam has filled the void.
I think my opinion comes in strong here because I think the show really sets you up to like Rob. And I think that I'm like totally 100% the person who the show sets up. And so I'm going to like the people the show is telling me to like. And if it's like, you should hate Jamie for season 1, but now in season 3, you should start to love him. That's what I'm going to do. And that's what's happening right now. That's what happened with Rob. I was like, he's the one chance for the Starks. I want to see this happen. And so I'm just like, I'm still in pain with my people here. Like, Rob,
it was a tragic letdown.
I hate Leon.
Speaking of loss of hope and humanity, you know. But let's before we move on to the epic duel.
Sid.
Roos and Ramsay. Have a moment. I just want the world to know, Roos Bolton might be the stupidest man in Westeros. Why is he the stupidest man in Westeros? Why is he stupider than Joffrey or anyone else? He's stupid because he just named a borderline sociopath. A full-on sociopath as the Warden of the North when he dies. The person who's going to rule the biggest lands likes to flay people and hunt women with his dogs. And you know about it. And he's going to rule over the North. You're going to give him that power. Holy crap.
You thought it was bad before. It's about to get worse. I kind of like Ramsay. I think that he may be really messed up, but he fits in perfectly in that world. I mean, he totally is like he's a, in a way that Arya is sort of becoming a victim of circumstance. I think he is to an extent, like growing up a bastard and having to deal with all this crap he had to deal with and being honored by his father for flaying and torturing people. That's just what he is now, and he's, like, perfect for it. So I think that maybe he's, like, a heartless douche, but he also is, like, really powerful because of that.
Yeah. You know, I'll give you that. I mean, even though I just said he was I would never put Ramsay Bolton in charge of anything, just period. But I actually kind of like Ramsay, too. And when I say like, I don't mean, like, yes, he's my favorite character, but he brings a fun dynamic to the show. I mean, he's crazy. He makes Joffrey... He's somehow more morbid and evil and more dangerous than Joffrey, but is also more likable than Joffrey too. I don't know how to describe it.
He's a super valuable character for the show.
Right.
He is someone everyone can kind of hate on a little bit. I like him because of that. Essentially, he's the evil guy.
He brings an interesting dynamic, like sort of like the Joker does to Batman. You know, like. So there's some people that you have some sort of level of likability for the Joker because of the dynamic he brings for Batman, the way that he challenges Batman. And I think that's sort of like what Ramsay does for the world of Westeros. He brings that dynamic that it's just he challenges everything. You know what I mean?
And I mean, like, there's just something funny about, like, in a way that Joffrey was despicable, I find Ramsay kind of clever. It's really weird. Yes. So like, okay, I love how he writes that in that letter. He's like, if you surrender the raise your white flag and surrender, Lord Bolton will be just as fair to you as he has been with me. And I was like, yes, he can, you know, and it just was so funny because it's like they don't know what he did to Dion. They have no idea. And then, of course, he goes in and flays all of them. I mean, it was just.
But they should know.
Darkly funny about that because it's terrible.
They should know what they did to Theon. I mean, Yara knew. She had the letter. She read it to people.
Did she read it to everybody, though?
I mean, obviously not. They should have known.
They should have. And also, and you have to remember, too, that the guy who actually surrendered wasn't the smartest guy. He couldn't even read the paper.
Yeah.
He's like, this paper, it says if we surrender, does it mean we live? Why, yes. Yes, it does. And then he's flayed. So.
Yeah. Next scene, there's a spear in his head, and he has no spoon.
Yeah. Yeah, it was messed up.
That was gross too, man.
Oh, it was so
nasty.
Gross.
And it wasn't the worst thing about it. It wasn't even the grossest thing we saw this week.
Yeah. Oh gosh.
Yeah, man.
All right, let's just do it.
On that
let's
note, guys, it. It's time to go. We have to go there. We've put it off for a long time, and we're gonna go to King's Landing before we get to the big fight because we're almost there.
Yeah, this scene was awesome.
This
I love
little
this
scene between Tyrion and Jaime. And this little soliloquy about the frickin' Beatles is an underlying theme in Game of Thrones. Why does our cousin smash the Beatles? I don't know. Yeah, he just
exactly.
does.
Why does George R. R. Martin smash the Beatles?
Yeah. There's a point to it. Clearly there's a point to it, but we cannot figure out what.
and maybe the person smashing the Beatles doesn't know what the point is, but he just keeps on doing it. And you know it fulfills some sort of purpose. And all of us have witnessed bugs getting smashed in this show. Over and over again, they just keep getting smashed. And I think, Austin, you're joking, but I seriously think that this is a little interesting parallel to Game of Thrones.
No, I think that's exactly what it's getting at. I do. I think that is the exact point of it. Whether you make it from the writer and it's like a little like kind of breaking of the fourth wall a little bit, or if you're saying the powers that be, essentially like Cersei and Tywin or whoever. But I think George R. R. Martin put that there to say, I don't really know where I'm going with this, but we're going to keep doing it.
This is your clue that Oberyn's about to die.
Yeah, basically. Anytime, I mean, he's just another bug getting squashed, and that's just how the machine works. And we're not really sure how it works. It does kind of underlie a thing that like just things just happen. And we don't always understand it. We don't really know why. And we don't like it. And you have people like Tyrion. And you have people like Tyrion who are saying why, and then they're studying it so hard,
and they can just not figure it out.
And then you've got characters like Jaime, who says, "Who gives a dusty about a bunch of beetles?" You know what I mean? So, I think it's a really great monologue underlying the themes of the show, Tyrion's position, and just how the world works.
It was just a nice little moment with probably maybe one of the last moments we'll get with Tyrion and Jaime. Like, it was just a nice little, again, one of those cool moments, like they are brothers and they just enjoy spending time with one another.
Yeah. Even if they don't really understand, like, clearly Jamie's like, what the heck are you talking about?
They kind of joke back and forth, right. And it was just a good moment for them.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. Like, they don't necessarily have to always understand exactly each other, but they still love each other. And you can, I don't know, I really feel the warmth coming off that relationship.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But now it's time.
If you look at this in the left corner, you'll see Oberyn fucks half of Westeros Martell gearing up with a spear.
You're going to fight that?
I'm going to kill that.
Don't leave me alone in this world.
Never.
If you look in the right corner, you see his arch nemesis who raped his sister Elia, Gregor the Mountain Clegane.
He's the biggest man I've ever seen.
Size does not matter when you're flat on your back.
All right, gentlemen, let's keep this clean.
Have they told you who I am?
Some dead man.
I am the brother of Elia Martell. And you know why I've come all the way to this stinking shit pile of a city?
fight.
For you?
I'm going to hear you confess before you die. You raped my sister. You murdered her. You killed her children. Say it now and we can make this quick.
Elia Martell. I killed her children. Then I raped her. Then I smashed her head.
I legit was like 95% certain Oberyn was coming out of this.
Yeah,
you really were. I really was. I was. And this was the most heartbreaking, soul-crushing thing I've ever seen. It was by far the worst death in the show for me. And I didn't even want to say it in previous weeks, but this is my favorite character probably in the show ever so far. I don't want to say it because... this, I can't have nice things.
This is why we can't have nice things, Barry!
And then it's just taken away. And so, as this is happening, as this scene's going on, the fight, phenomenal. It's just so, so good. And I thought, he won. It's fantastic. He's calling out. He's about to throw the spear through the sky and impale Tywin as well. And we're just going to take out everybody right now. Fantastic. And then he gets punched in the face. I'm like, oh, shit. Well, that kind of sucks. He's going to be all right, though. He'll be fine. And then he starts getting choked. I'm like, well, I hope he can reach his spear. It's going to be okay. Then his eyes are gouged out. And I'm thinking, ooh, he's going to be blind, but he can still fumble for his spear. It's going to be okay.
Oh, man.
And then it just ends. For a second, the same thoughts that went through my head with Ned were this was a dream. Like, this didn't really happen. It's going to be like, haha, just kidding. And I should know better by now. Like, the show has never done anything like that ever. But it still went through my head. And it was awful. It was the worst thing. And so we're all sitting there on the couch just screaming at the television. And the show ends, and we sit there, and it's just silent. I kid you not, for like 5 minutes, it's just quiet. It was so eerie and horrible, and this is why I'm no longer watching Game of Thrones.
I got a text from Austin. Okay, so unfortunately, viewers, I wasn't watching live. I sorely regret not watching this live, deeply, because I wanted to see the reaction with a bunch of non-book readers, but I knew the second it happened, because Austin sent a text that said, I am Caleb, find a new host. I can't watch the show anymore. I was just like, oh my gosh. And I knew this was coming, and it opened all the hurts up again. It made them worse.
Oh, yeah.
Because I knew it was coming. I was really upset when he died in the book too. Because again, it was such a visceral experience reading that in the book. And everyone loved Oberyn so much. He was a fan favorite for all the same reasons. And they made him even more likable in the show. And
he became one of my favorite characters in the show as well.
Like, they gave him more cool scenes. They added the whole "It delights me" speech. You know, all that great stuff. You know, and so you just think this guy's epic. He's a badass. And even though going to fight, it's like the Red Wedding all over again, guys. He's like, he says
it's so much worse than that.
It's that feeling though, because I knew he wasn't gonna make it going into the fight, and then he tells his wife says, "Don't leave me alone on this earth," and he's like, "Never," and I was like, "Oh god," and he says, "Today is not the day I die," and I was like, "Oh god," and then once the fight happened though, I was so like, just like in the book, except for even more so, I was so into it that I almost forgot for a second that he could have made it out.
Right, that's the killer for me. The killer for me is that he had him. He won that fight, and I think a lot of people are going to say this, and I heavily disagree with this. I think a lot of people are going to say he got too cocky. I think that's not the case at all. I think that he was very confident and he pulled it off. He was very aware of what he was capable of and he did it. But then he gets so emotionally overwhelmed with the idea of him admitting and saying his sister's name that he puts down his guard a little bit. I don't think it's out of cockiness that he ends up dying. Yeah, I think it's because of his love and emotional obsession with hearing the mountain say those words that he didn't pull the trigger when he just should have. And he should have. And that's what sucks about it so much, is that he had it. Like, he really legitimately had it. He could have just killed him and been done with it. But he just got so emotionally overwhelmed with the idea of his sister that he couldn't do it until he heard the words.
And that's what we love about him. So at least he went down like how we loved him, like in the whole season, you know?
Right.
Because he is that guy who wears his emotions right on his sleeve and is going to do whatever he wants to do. And he was so caught up with, like, I need this to be satisfied. This thing I've thought my whole life, it has to be satisfied. I have to hear him say that he did it and then kill him, that it just ended up being the death of him. What is that? Is that hubris? I think it was his pride a little bit. I think it was his pride a little bit that ended up being his downfall.
Well, he was.
I don't want to believe that because I love him so much.
I mean, I think still you're definitely onto something, and I will say there's definitely a hint of pride there. Because just of how he went into it and how he was so flashy about it and, you know, like everyone, he was a crowd pleaser. But no, I think ultimately you're right. His fatal flaw was not his arrogance, but it really was his obsession with getting that confession. With justice, really. Because he didn't just want to kill him. He wanted him to suffer, and he wanted him to tell him that he killed his sister.
He wanted
him to apply Tywin Lannister so that he could righteously kill Tywin Lannister.
That was the key. He wanted him to implicate Tywin. Because now he know. Then in a public arena, Tywin is now tied to this.
Yeah, Tywin is the one who ordered him to rape and kill. That's the kind of man Tywin is. Which, damn it, wouldn't it have been awesome if he actually pulled it off?
So let's talk about this.
He pulled it off for like a. Yeah, he had it. Oh, it kills me.
Let's talk about this now. I am pissed that this happened. Not even because I really liked Oberyn. But because Oberyn had so much more to do from a character perspective.
Oh, yeah.
He was like just an interesting, dynamic character. And he might have died horribly at some point later in the future. That's fine. But I didn't feel like his story was over. And I feel like the people who remained after this fight, Tywin and Cersei, I feel like they've already peaked and they're going on the downhill as far from a story perspective. Unless something drastic changes... Most of the season, they've been really flat and kind of boring. And I'm sick of the Lannisters. I'm just sick of them. I don't find them interesting anymore. It's not even that I hate them or I dislike them. They're just not interesting, right. Which is worst for a story.
Well, and I don't think it's going to wreck the story. I don't think it's going to wreck the story. But, Austin, I do want to point out this is you are playing – and again, all of us played in it. I mean, obviously lots of viewers played in this. But this is people playing into the expectation. Oh, this guy's got rich. He could do so many things. He's such a rich and interesting person. How many rich and interesting people just die every day? You know.
But I'm just talking from like a story enjoyment perspective.
Well, I know.
You know, now it's boring again.
I know. Well, you say that now.
I don't know that yet. I don't know where it's going to go.
You're a little wrapped up here because I mean there have been a lot of really great things happening this season outside of Oberyn. I love Oberyn, but I'm just saying, you know, yes, the Lannisters might not be as interesting and exciting, and that's why another thing I think expectations people play, and myself played into, was this is a new character who's breathing life into the show, because you always introduce new characters who are going to bring in some new perspectives every season this happens, and usually those characters end up being around for a while, but this is Game of Thrones, and it subverted our expectations. I guarantee you there were people out there who were sitting there saying, he can't die, he just came in this season, and we all like him, and he's got a lot of things he could be doing after this is done. So there's no way he's going to die just because that's not how stories work. Well, we see how it went.
That happens to everyone.
Going back to what Austin sort of said at the beginning, I think this was, for me, even after Ned and Rob and all that, this was probably the most emotional death for me. In the show, not so much so in the book, but in the show, this really just, and again, like we should know this by now, after everything that's happened, everything we've seen, we should know that the good don't win most of the time. The people that we want, the people that we like, oftentimes die, and this was the moment where, like, you know, we say all the time, well, our main character can always die, but then yet we still believe that Oberyn was going to live. Like Austin was saying, 95% sure he was going to make it out of this. And this is the moment for really me where I just lose hope with the world of Westeros. I really believe, like,
it's a little melancholy and depressing.
You know, after all the deaths that have happened, you think we would have known by now that this kind of thing can happen. But we still, for some reason, we put hope in Oberyn that he's going to be the one that overcomes and all this stuff, and he doesn't. And this is, for me, the moment where I completely lose hope with the world of Westeros. Not that I'm going to stop watching or whatever, but I think this is the moment where I finally buy into the world of the good will not win. And this death affected me more than any other death.
It's just so heartbreaking. It's even, I mean, in some ways it is more heartbreaking than the Red Wedding, I guess. I mean, I think I liked Oberyn a lot more than I liked Robin Catelyn. And even though they represented a lot of really important things, it's like at some point you expect finally a figure to come in and actually do justice. Because we've seen so much injustice happen, and we're like, finally, this is the guy who's going to... It's not even like it was a major victory. Yes, he was killing the Mountain, and he was implying Tywin, which is great. I mean, those are both... Those are justices that need to be served, right? But it's still... no one knew who the... I mean, no one really knew who the Mountain was before this season, right? I mean, like, he'd appeared a couple times, but no one really knows who he was, right? And then we all know those things about Tywin anyway. So it's like, just a hint of justice being served is...
Can we take a moment to show some appreciation for Pedro Pascal? He was fantastic playing Oberyn.
He was so good. Excellent.
And if you don't follow him on Twitter, he has been hilarious. One of the tweets he sent out was, "I shit you not, I can't get rid of this headache." But he was, I can't even picture anyone else playing that character.
Yeah, he did a phenomenal job.
It was so great.
He definitely was, when I read him in the books, Pedro Pascal falls in line. And what really, I mean, I liked him all through the season, and I thought he did a good job. But what really sold me was the fight, like, where I was like, this guy, like, there's no way I can ever, you know how when you read a character, and sometimes it's like when you're reading, I don't know, it's like I was reading Harry Potter. I don't remember who Severus Snape looked like before Alan Rickman, even though there was a version of him before Alan Rickman that I remember picturing in my head. I don't remember what he looks like. Some of the other characters, a lot of the other characters, I remember what they looked like beforehand, but not Severus Snape. Pedro Pascal certainly filled that void with the same void with me with Oberyn.
Yeah, I agree.
Because now it's like I can't, anytime I read the book, if I read book three again, or I'm sure whenever I read book three again, it's going to be Pedro Pascal. And I'm just going to be like, I don't remember what that guy looks like beforehand.
I think it was you I was talking to, Caleb, before the season started, but we were talking about them casting Pedro Pascal, and I was like a little bit hesitant. I don't want to say I was pessimistic, but I was like, I don't know, just because it wasn't like the guy I had imagined, and I think you maybe shared the sentiment, but he just totally blew my expectations out of the water. And like you're saying, now I can't remember who I even thought the Red Viper was beforehand.
Hats off to Pedro Pascal. This fight was epic, guy. I mean... and we can even take a second to talk about how awesome this fight was. Like, they executed
choreography
so well.
Was amazing.
Oh, like all those flips and crap he was doing, and then he got.
And whoever,
like,
the stunt guy was, I assume it was a stunt guy.
Yeah,
was fantastic. It was just so good.
I mean, yeah. This is one of the, if not the most iconic. Well, let's say one of the most iconic scenes from the whole series. And I mean, I know fans have been highly anticipating this. Even some people even more so than the Red Wedding. And I think they pulled it off in flying colors. And the brutality. I mean, the thing that is going to haunt me about it more than anything. Yes, the gouging the eyes is terrible, but the scream. The blood shrilling scream when fingers are going in his eyes. That's the thing that haunts me.
You want to look away, but you can't. It's one of those moments.
That's the thing. That's what's crazy about it. I knew it was coming, and even in that moment, I felt like I half a second looked away. Like, I was like, I couldn't take it. Like,
I wish I would have looked away. Holy crap. His face after that was done, I was like, oh God, I can't unsee it. It's there.
I was in denial the whole time until the minute his head explodes. I was in denial.
That's exactly how it was actually with Ned when the whole Caleb probably remembers. I was just like the credits roll. I'm like, he's not dead. It's something happened.
So kudos to the creators of Game of Thrones for once again, time after time they have pulled off these epic moments: Blackwater, the Red Wedding, Tyrion's trial, and now the battle between the Mountain and the Hound. These people have really just knocked out of the park with all these really big iconic moments, and having them live up, and honestly, in some ways, I don't want to say exceed, but like create an experience that's altogether different than what we imagine in the books. And gosh, yeah, D.B. Weiss and Dan, I always forget their names, but those two guys are just incredible. And they're
doing
a great job.
I don't know if it's a Freudian slip or not, but you keep saying the mountain and the hound.
I don't know why I do the mountain and the viper, dang it. I don't know.
He's not Freudian slipping anything, at least from where I'm at that, so.
Yeah. So, guys, let's take a moment to remember the epic character that was Oberyn Martell.
I want to bring those who have wronged me to justice, and all those who have wronged me are right here. I will begin with Sir Gregor Clegane, who killed my sister's children and then raped her with their blood still on his hands before killing her too. I will be your champion. Tell your father I'm here. And tell him the Lannisters aren't the only ones who pay their debts.
Well, you went uptown riding in your limousine with your fine Park Avenue clothes.
You're a Prince of Dawn. A legendary fighter. A brilliant man feared throughout Westeros. But you could not save your sister.
Long sword is a bad option in close quarters.
Because you had to be a big shot, didn't you? You had to open up your mouth. You had to be a big shot, didn't you? All your friends were so knocked out. You had to have the last word last night. You know what everything's about. You had to have a white hot spotlight. You had to be a big shot last night. Oh.
Have they told you who I am?
Some dead man.
I am the brother of Elia Martell. And you know why I've come all the way to this stinking shit pile of a city? For you?
Everyone is missing half the world's pleasure. The gods made that, and it delights me. The gods made this, and it delights me.
Today is not the day I die. Gave you the order?
Who gave you the order? Say her name! You raped her! You murdered her! You killed her children!
Say her name.
Say it!
Elia Martell! I killed her children! Then I smash their head in like this!
Oh, big shot!
Big shot! What about what I want? Justice. For my sister and her children.
If you want justice, you've come to the wrong place.
All right, guys. So one of our listeners, Chris, asked the question, and it's perfect, Chris. You're like reading my mind, man. The question I want to ask, you know, Oberyn Martell is dead. What does that mean for Westeros and the story? Because I think the big thing we've got, and this is what's so great about the fight, is you get so wrapped up in the fight, you forget Tyrion's life is on the line.
Yeah.
He just really died, and Tyrion is going to get executed. Like,
he just got sentenced to death. I mean, there's no other way to get around that. Yeah. Tywin stood up and said, time to die.
Yeah.
And what does it mean for Dorne, too? I mean, because this is the second person, like, important person from Dorne killed by the Mountain.
Oh, yeah.
And also, maybe on orders from the Lannisters. I mean, what does that mean between the people of Dorne and the Lannisters, the Martells and the Lannisters? What does that mean now for them? There's going to be some bad news there. Because they also have Cersei's daughter.
Even though Oberyn is gone, I do think that the Martells are going to be are becoming more important as a family, as a place.
Well, and we even hinted in our bonus episode last week with that leaked cask announcement that the Martells are going to definitely have a role to play next season.
I think there will definitely be some. We would see a little bit more of that side of things, which I'm super pumped for. So,
yeah.
Maybe I never learn, but I think Tyrion's safe. I probably should know better by now.
You just watched the same episode we did, right?
You did just watch the die, right?
I think he's okay. I think maybe Jamie saves him.
How is he? Okay.
I want you to tell Austin. I want you to tell me how he's getting out.
If he gets out of it, how?
It was all an elaborate ruse. and Cersei never actually really wanted him dead because Cersei actually killed Joffrey, as we all know. I don't know. But I'm broken right now, so if he dies, fine, whatever.
Wow. When you're saying it's okay that Tyrion dies, you've got depression, man.
Tyrion's still like much bigger to me, more important to me than Oberyn was, even though Oberyn was more on some level like there was more fun and exciting moments, just from the season anyway, at least. I don't know, like you can't – like you were saying before about Oberyn – you know, like if Oberyn were to die, I'm done watching the show. I couldn't say that about Oberyn, but I feel like I would like to say that about Tyrion.
I feel like at this point, you could close out Tyrion's storyline. It would feel okay. That's how I feel.
You wouldn't be sad? I'd be freaking sad.
I'd be sad, but it wouldn't be shocking, obviously, because he just sentenced to death. So not shocking. But I feel like he has peaked. You know, his storyline's kind of climaxed. It's coming down. Some resolution involved. He can't run away from death forever. He could die, and I'd be okay with it.
If he dies.
Okay with it, but I don't think he's going to. I really don't
see
how he's going to, but I don't know how he gets out.
I don't see how he's going to get out of it. How? Okay, give me a scenario on how he gets out of it.
Jaime smuggles him out, or Varys does.
Interesting. That's actually what.
That's his only two friends.
The thing is, yes, but people know those are his only two friends, so you think they wouldn't be suspected?
Yeah, but
interesting as you say that. My
get a price for that? No.
I also want to point this out, guys. And this is totally sidestepping this discussion right here. I just want everyone to know how pissed I was, and I have talked and we've talked at length at how much we all respect Tywin. I freaking hated Tywin when this episode was over. When he got up and said the gods have decided, I was like, you son of a bitch. This is all your fault. This is all your freaking fault for not letting Tyrion off the hook, for letting Cersei do what she does, not being a good judge. This is all your fault. And then two, when Cersei had that dang smug on her face when this happened, I just wanted to freaking punch her in the face hardcore.
Her day is coming very, very soon, I think.
One thing I would like to point out I really liked about the scene as well is Jaime's facial expressions during, because they kept going to Jaime. It shows you how much they really do, Jaime and Tyrion really do care about each other because you see this like smile on Jaime's face. He's like, all right, Tyrion's going to make, like, you know, when Oberyn's sort of in the more powerful position, you see Jaime sort of smile. He's like, all right, my brother's going to make it. And then you just see it turn into horror, like with us, you know, and Jaime's like, crap. Like, he's really upset, obviously, that this is actually going to happen. I don't know how you guys are.
There's only so many options. This, maybe Bronn does it finally. Maybe he finally, like,
man's up.
Is like, hey, I help you. I don't know.
I just.
It's a tough spot. It would be a really interesting smuggle. And if that was the case, both or either Varys or Jaime would be in terrible positions because they would be the first suspects.
They need Han Solo. Yeah. That's who they need.
I have a hard time seeing him get out of this one.
Man, just don't get in the Lannisters' way. That's all I'm thinking right now. Like, anyone who poses any threat to them just seems to be going down. Even Tyrion, if he's part of their family.
Well, see, and that's the thing is, like, you don't even have to pose like a major one. Like, Tyrion honestly was never in any sort of danger of getting in the Lannisters' way. In fact, in some ways, he helped them out. But he's just the little comments that he made got him framed, basically.
This is precisely the only reason I like Stannis, is I think he's the only one who could legitimately wipe out the Lannisters at this point.
To get back to Chris's question, the main takeaways are the Lannisters are a bunch of they all deserve to die, except for Jaime and Tyrion. So really, just Tywin and Cersei. One. Two, Dorne is going to want vengeance. If this is how obsessed Oberyn Martell is, yes, for Elia dying years after the fact, what do you think Dorne is going to do now that he's dead? I mean, everyone freaking loved that guy. So...
Yeah. And it wasn't even... Oberyn that was supposed to be coming to King's Landing. It was supposed to be his brother, Dorne, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The king.
So then there's that card too, where it's like Oberyn went on behalf of someone else, and so it shouldn't have even been him there in the first place.
I don't see this ending happily just across the board. Can we just say that? Even say Tyrion gets out of it, I don't think things are going to end happy for anybody. Tyrion could get out of this, somebody will pay. Someone we all like is going to pay. We all like Varys. We all like Tyrion. We all like Jaime.
We already paid. What more do we have to pay?
This is Game of Thrones, Austin. We paid double. They charge $55 so you can go in to see your matinee in the movie theater. Okay. They charge you $500. They charge you a pinky if you want to get a popcorn. Okay.
This I is paid Game enough. God damn it! And I'm not gonna do it again.
Okay. Is the mountain alive? Is he dead? He got stabbed in the stomach. I swear. Like
that's a good point.
He probably the bastard probably comes out of it.
Like what is that?
Okay.
How does he have the strength after that? I mean,
we were talking about this last night. I guess it's the whoever die. Like, I guess they could both technically die. It's just whoever dies first.
Yeah.
Then that.
Well,
then the victor.
We can all agree Oberyn died first.
Oh, yes. Yes. Yeah. Well, so that's why that Tyrion gets sent to death. But that, I guess the mountain could just die afterwards of bleeding out or whatever.
We don't know. We didn't see. I mean, we saw him like pass out, but he could still be alive, unconscious. I mean, we don't really know.
This is why Tyrion should have chosen the flaming sword guy as his champion. Because he'd just rise back up.
Oh, dude, why didn't you do that? Beric Dondarrion.
Oh, dude, that's such a good
point. I
forgot.
We could have done that at the beginning. Beric Dondarrion versus anybody in Westeros. That would be awesome.
Right. Infinite chances.
Dear God, wow.
And like, awesome. he was like, you didn't kill him, so the
you cut
fight
him in half. He cuts himself in half, and then he regrows legs, and he's like, "What now?"
He's Deadpool. That's who he is.
The gods clearly say that I'm innocent because you're coming back to life. So
you gotta watch out for Beric Deadpool Dondarrion. He's pretty deadly. He's gonna start breaking the next thing you know. He's gonna start breaking the fourth wall. This has been fun, and I want us to remember Oberyn Martell. He was a great character. I loved Oberyn. It was sad to read him die in the books, and gosh. I didn't realize a character I knew was going to die would hurt me so much. I mean, the Red Wedding hurt, but I knew that was coming and I was prepared, and it didn't. The preparation actually helped. But this thing, man, I was literally furious when it was done. Like, I was shouting. I was like, freaking Mountain, freaking Tywin. I was upset, and it opened some hurts I didn't know hurt anymore. So, good on you, show. This was a sad week. Very sad week. I just want to remind all of our listeners that you can find us at facebook.com/castbeyondthewall. Or you can follow us on Twitter @cast_beyond_GOT. And you can hit that, if you're watching on YouTube, hit that nice little subscribe button right under our name. Really like that. And most importantly, please, please, please subscribe to us on iTunes and give us a rating. Even if you think we're terrible, give us 1 star. Just give us ratings. We like. I do want to read some feedback from former guest host Dalton Stewart. He sent some in earlier today. And he said, Austin is riding the Stark train more like a love train, or is it a crazy train? He was referencing Austin's love for wanting his dream to see Bran take the throne. And yes, Austin, you are riding the crazy train.
Maybe I am.
But that's
I never actually thought about it that way, but maybe I need to rethink it now. No more Stark.
There's no more Stark hope. I mean, Sansa's turning into, like, a queen bee, manipulative, crazy. Arya's turning into just the freaking Joker or the next Jack the Ripper.
All right, I change it. Yara Greyjoy.
Oh my gosh.
She is the throne.
Austin.
The Greyjoys, man.
Really? I thought we were past this. I thought we agreed the Greyjoys aren't doing Jack.
They're going to. Their time is coming, Caleb. I know it. And then as soon as they do something awesome, they're going to die because George R. R. Martin's a terrible person. Greyjoy's for life.
Keep bleeding. Keep bleeding love. All right.
Okay, well, let's be... Yeah.
Right, we should cut that. That needs cut.
So, no, that's gonna. Are you kidding me? That's gonna go. That's gonna make it in. So everybody, before we wrap the show, let's go ahead and prehash the next week's episode, the infamous / famous episode 9, where the crap usually goes down. Even though I'm pretty sure this week was like an episode 9, and episode 2 is an episode 9, and yeah, let's just wrap that out. But we're gonna prehash next week's episode, the Watchers on the Wall. Okay, so we already talked a little bit about this earlier, but it looks like we're going to be focusing exclusively on the Wall next week. And we're going to see some... Do you think we're going to be able to see a battle that tops Blackwater? Because Blackwater may be one of the most impressive battles I've ever seen on TV, or, well, just ever seen.
I will say yeah. I'll go ahead and say yes to that. I just think that I think the stakes are a little bit higher here. Not obviously for the specific characters, but for the world. I think the world of Russia is a little bit more in danger because of what happens. Because if the wall fails, then you've got wildlings coming straight through the wall, which is not good. And then right after that, you've got White Walkers coming. So I think that if the wall fails, the consequences of that are so much greater than that of Blackwater that. I think there's going to be a lot more at stake during this fight, which so I think part of that will cause a lot of different things. And then you're going to have the whole Jon Snow fighting against some of his friends and the person that he loves more than anything also. So there's going to be that whole dynamic. So I think their whole – I don't know. For me, I think they will be able to top it.
They've got a lot left in that CG budget, I think.
They do. They've been holding back all season.
Yeah, that's right. They're gonna blow their whole load here on the episode 9 again.
Right. Yeah. It's gonna be good, and I think we're gonna see some casualties. I'd imagine. I think John. You could. This is Game of Thrones. I would venture to say John is probably safe, but everyone else is kind of free range. That includes Mr. Samwell Tarly.
102 men versus 100,000. Okay. I'm just gonna point that out. Everybody's dead.
I'm just cautiously optimistic that Ygritte and Jon will get back together. That's what I'm hoping for.
Seriously. They're all going to die, and what's going to happen is they're going to get this fight, and Jon is going to backstab the Night's Watch the last second and be like, I'm on your side the whole time. And then him...
Going to kill the freaking Lord Commander or whoever it is.
Yeah, he's going to kill... What's his name? Yeah, that guy. Thorne, Alistair Thorne, and then he's going to take Ygritte, and they're going to go like freaking power bang off in the commander's chambers or something like that. That's how it's going to happen. And then the wildlings are going to fight the Boltons, which is going to be epic.
That would be ideal.
So, but I think we're in for a really good episode next week. I'm very excited.
So,
needless to say.
I was, my mind started racing with this Bolton wildling thing, and the Boltons really like to flay people, but the Thins just like to eat people. So I think that's way more gruesome.
That's true. Ramsay Bolton could be a wildling, I guess, with his like total brutality. Maybe could start eating people. Maybe they could show him. Maybe they'll show him how to fry people's skin. And he'll be like, We should have hooked up a long time ago.
Okay, Austin, this is your last hope. This is like Star Wars Episode 4, okay?
Okay.
The Thins are going to be within proximity of Sam, okay?
Oh, he's going to be a delicious, delicious, fat little piggy.
Now, oh my God, Austin. I kind of wish I would have brought that up now. Okay, anyway, so if you want to see... All right, viewers out there should tune in and listen to to see if the Finns actually eat Samwell, and then come back and see what all. Either Austin's going to be having a party next week, or we're going to have a new guest host. Because after Oberyn and Sam surviving, I'm pretty sure Austin is going to quit Game of Thrones forever.
We need to see some hashtags out there, guys. Okay, I'm going to search for this later. It's going to be hashtag Eat Sam.
Okay. Oh my gosh,
that's right, everyone who's tuning in, hashtag Eat Sam, and make sure to tag the cast beyond the wall. We'll give you a prize, and by a prize I mean a shout out tweet, because we love you guys,
because we have no money, we're very poor.
Yeah. True. but we're like Littlefinger, we may come from nothing, but we will rise through the ranks and rule Westeros with all the other podcasts. All right, everybody, well, thank you so much. I think that's a great show. I just want to say thank you so much to Drew for coming in this week. We always love hearing your voice and hearing your comments. Even if you think you're just a stereotypical Game of Thrones viewer, which I know you're not, I really appreciate your perspective, sir.
Hey, I'm proud to be a stereotypical viewer. Someone's got to represent us, man.
We love you, Drew.
George R. Martin tells us to do subtly through great writing.
And then you're like, crap, you son of a bitch. You tricked me again.
Yeah, exactly. He toys with our emotions.
He does a lot. Well, all right, guys. I think that's all we've got time for this week. Make sure to tune in next week when we review The Watchers of the Wall. It's going to be freaking epic.
No, I'm more afraid of. It's going to end with Sam Tarly and Hodor just headbutting each other. That's it. That's the end of the show. Fuck the podcast. Fuck the show. Fuck George R. R. Martin.